If you are interested in sequence-to-sequence learning, I have a good news for you. Recently, I have been working on sequence-to-sequence learning and I decided to prepare a series of tutorials about sequence-to-sequence learning from a simple multi-layer perceptron neural network model to an encoder-decoder model with attention. If you like to follow up the tutorials, please subscribe to my channel and activate the notifications now. Thank you. First of all, I would like to show my Colab notebook here, and these are the references and the resources that I used to prepare this tutorial. Here is the sequence-to-sequence learning tutorial series I prepared for you. You can access all my sequence-to-sequence learning videos on Murat Karakaya Academy YouTube channel in English or in Turkish. You can access to my blog on Medium as well. I will begin with a simple solution implemented by multi-layer perceptron network up to implementing an encoder-decoder model with some attention layers. As you notice that we have lots of parts. Why? Our aim is to code an encoder-decoder model with attention. However, I would like to develop the solution by showing the shortcomings of other possible solutions, and I would like to develop the perfect solution step by step and discussing all the necessary information with you. Therefore, in the first two parts, part A and part B, we will observe the initial models have their own weaknesses, and we will focus on how to remove these weaknesses with new or novel models. We also understand why encoder-decoder paradigm is so powerful and successful. Please patiently follow the parts as we develop a better solution. Here are the libraries. I will include these libraries. To further continue our coding, I already developed two important functions. One of the functions to prepare the sequence-to-sequence dataset, and the other function is to train and test a given model. I will come to these auxiliary functions in 10 minutes. Let's begin with the sequence-to-sequence learning. First of all, the definitions. What is a sequence? Sequence is a particular order in which related things follow each other. The key is here the order and the related things. Sequence-to-sequence learning, or shortly sec-to-sec learning, is about training models to convert sequence from one domain, for example a sentence in English, to sequences in another domain, for example some sentences translated to French. The third important definition for us is the parallel data sets. Like most machine learning models, effective sequence-to-sequence learning requires massive amounts of training data in order to produce correct results. A parallel data set is a structured set of sequences between input and output. Such parallel data sets are essential for training sequence-to-sequence models. In that tutorial, we are going to create our parallel data sets together. Now let me show you an example for sequence-to-sequence model, actually which is originated from that concept, machine translation model. So you provided one sentence or one statement in one language, and the model will create the, or translate the input to another language in sentence. Here you see a parallel text dataset. In the parallel text datasets, you see that the first one is a statement from French and the other is the translated one. So this is our training data, for example, and each statements are parallel. It means that the first statement in French is translated the first statement in English in that set. So we have the A and B sets. That's the idea. But it's not only we use the encoder-decoder model in text translation, but we can use lots of different places. For example, in image captioning, we input an image and we expect the sequence-to-sequence model produce a caption for that image in text. You notice that the input sequence here is the pixels of a picture, Here the output sequence is the words in one language. Okay, let's see more examples about sequence-to-sequence problems. As we already seen, machine translation and image captioning, I am passing out these. Here is the video captioning. As you can imagine, it is automatically creating the subtitles of a video for each frame. And text summarization, condensing a piece of text to a shorter version, reducing the size of the initial text while at the same time preserving key information and of course the meaning of the content. Another area is where we can use the encoder decoder is the question answering. So we can generate a natural language answer in text or in speech when a natural language question arrives. Conversational modeling is very interesting area. You might heard about the chatbots. So simulating a conversation or a chat with a user in natural language throughout messaging applications, websites, mobile applications, or through the telephone. Speech recognition simply is converting a speech to a text. Time series forecasting, predicting future values based on previously observed values of a time series. Most commonly, a time series is a sequence taken at a successively equally spaced points in time. Heights of ocean tides, counts of sunspots, and the daily closing value of the sun bonds. Let's talk about how to categorize these problems. Actually, I can categorize these problems by using two dimensions of the problem. The first dimension I would like to use the length of the input and output sequences. These sequences' lengths can be fixed or variable. In text translation, you know that the input and output sequences' length could be different and variable. The second way to categorize the sec-to-sec problems is looking at the data types of the input and output sequences. They can be same, for example, text. So translation from one language to another, they are both text. It could be different. Remember the image captioning? In the image captioning, one of the input data type is image pixels and the output of the sequence data type is just text. So in real life, most of the problems are variable lengths and mixed data types in input and output sequences. For the sake of simplicity, I will begin with a fixed length and same data type sequence problem. But in the upcoming parts, we will develop the model such that we are gonna handle the variable length sequences as problem. Let's focus on how to solve sec-to-sec learning problems. In literature or in practice, there are several approaches to solve sec-to-sec problems. However, in this tutorial, we will focus on encoder, decoder, model or paradigm. In the encoder, decoder paradigm, we are gonna use neural networks that maps the input of a sequence to an output sequence with a tag and attention value. In the implementation of the encoder, decoder models in neural networks, we can use two types of neural networks, recurrent or convolutional. Or we can use both of them. But in these tutorials, I will focus on recurrent neural networks. The main advantage of encoder-decoder framework is that it requires little featuring engineering and domain specificity. It means that these are generic networks that can learn from different domains and with different features. In this tutorial, we will go over several models. So we will begin with, in this video, multilayer perceptron network. Then in the next video, we will go on to LSTM, which is a recurrent neural network model. Then we will create our basic encoder decoder model with LSTM. Then we will introduce teaching forcing and attention mechanism as Budhoe style or long style, and hopefully we will end up with beam searching. Before starting, I hope that you already know Python, Keras, TensorFlow, deep neural network concepts, recurrent neural network concepts, LSTMs, and LSTM parameters and the outputs, and of course Keras functional API. If you would like to refresh your knowledge about above topics, check Murat Karaga Academy resources on YouTube or Medium. Or you can access the Colab notebooks. Let's create a simple sequence-to-sequence problem. Assume that we are given a parallel data set, including X, which is an input, and Y, which is an output, such that X, I, and Y, I have some relationship. For instance, we are given the same books text in English as X and in Turkish as Y. So it means that the statement XI, the ith statement in the X dataset, can be translated to Turkish as the ith statement in the Y dataset. We use the parallel dataset to train a sequence-to-sequence model, which would learn how to convert or transform an input sequence from X to an output sequence Y. In that tutorial, I will generate X and Y parallel datasets such that Y sequence will be the reverse of the X sequence. Assume that X sequence is this sequence, so 3-2-9-1 sequence. It is corresponding Y sequence will be 1-9-2-3, which is reverse of the XI. I selected this simple idea because we need to focus on the encoder-decoder model, not focus on the preprocessing of the data. Here we have very few number of steps for preprocessing numbers. But in the upcoming tutorials, we are gonna talk about image captioning, text translation, etc., which requires lots of preprocessing. But for beginning with a simple example will help us to learn the concepts and implement the coding easier. Okay, now, in this sample sequence problem, input X and output Y sequences have fixed and same length and of course the same data type, integer. In the upcoming tutorials, after we build a basic encoder-decoder model, we will change or relax the problem such that we will be dealing with variable length sequences and different data types. Let's begin with how to configure the sample parallel data sets. So I mentioned that I already prepared some auxiliary functions. One of these functions for set up that sample data set. Here in that dataset we have some parameters. One of the parameters is the number of input steps. So how many tokens, distinct events, numbers or words, etc. in the input sequence. Let me show. Here you see that in the input sequence, at the zeroth input sequence, we have only 4 steps. 3, 2, 3, 0. So this is the number of input steps. Number of features. So how we represent each step in the encoder? So the dimensions of the representation. Here we are using the integers in each step, but we are gonna use one hot encoded format to represent one integer. So if you notice here, now there is only one here and the rest is zero. For the first step. So this is the 0, 1, 2, and 3 to represent the integers one hot encoded format. So we don't use the integer sequence as an input to the neural network model, but we are gonna use the one hot encoded format to supply the input to the neural network model. So this is the number of features here we are using. Okay, So we are gonna use the one-hot encoding to represent the integer numbers in the sequences. The length of one of the hot coding vectors is the number of features. So if we say that number of features 10, the greatest integer will be 9 in the sequence and will be represented with 10 zeros or 1 because the number of features is 10. I think it is clear. And train size and the test size are the number of samples in the train and test data sets. Here you see that in X-train shape is 20,000 by 4 by 10. Why 4? Because 4 is the number of steps. As you see that there are 4 inputs at each sequence. Why it is 10? Because each integer is represented by 10 one-hot encoding 0 or 1s. Okay. Now, we can focus on now our simple beginning solution using a multi-layer perceptron network. Actually, multi-layer perceptron network may have different meanings. One of the meaning is the perceptron, which is different from the neuron, but in the general concept, perceptron and neuron is accepted the same. So I am using perceptron here as neuron, okay, but not the recurrent neural network, not a convolutional neural network. I am just talking feed forward network. So I use multi-layer perceptron network. Okay. Here we are going to use the MLP model for a fixed size and same data type input and output sequences. How can we create the model? Actually, it is very easy to create that model with using Keras sequential API. And I think everybody knows this. Here, but in the future, we are going to use Keras functional API because we are going to use recurrent neural networks, etc. We begin with using the sequential keyword and give a model a name. And for adding layers, we use the keyword add to the model. And you see that I mostly use the dense layers, ending up with the dense layer. And we compile the model by using the categorical cross entropy. Why? Remember that we are using the one-hot encoding, so there are more than one classes, and we would like to be each class value calculated separately. So we are using categorical cross entropy. I use optimizer Adam, but you can use another one. And the matrix is as usual accuracy. After then I summary the model. Let me show the model here. Beginning with the input layer, then the dense layer first, second, third, and the last layer for the classification actually. And if you notice that the classification is shape of batch number, here is none is batch number. Number of steps 4, so the feature number is 10, so it will produce me 10 of 4 of 10 or 4 by 10 results. For each of them is the representation of an integer, so there will be 4 integers at the output. You can check the plot if you like. You see the input layer is 10 by 4 by 10 and the result is also 4 by 10. So here is the train and test function. As I mentioned that I already prepared this function for you, which is a helpful function. Let me show you the train and test function for you. Okay. In that function, I get the model and the train and test data sets and the epoch numbers and if it is verbose or not. And I use the early stopping with patience 20, focusing on validation loss. And of course, it should be getting minimum values. After the training is finished, I also evaluate the model by using the test and train data. And I report these. And I also plot these loss and accuracy values and some examples. So this is the function I prepared and I found it very handy. Let me continue with the train of our model. Okay. Now, so during training, 10% of the training data is reserved as validation. I implemented early stopping. It means that it will focus on validation accuracy, and whenever it does not change throughout the 20 epochs, it will stop automatically. Okay. Function will return accuracy for training and test data. Furthermore, we are gonna see the plots. Let me show the result after running. So you see that early stopping happens here. It stops because it does not, accuracy does not change, improve. So here, pay attention here. Our train accuracy is only 10% and test is about 10 again. So these are very, very low values. Check here. Now you see the accuracy for the train and test data. And if you focus on the train data, for the train data, we have the oscillated results. And for the validation data, we also very high oscillated results. It shows that the model cannot converge. So it means that it cannot learn actually. So what happens? Why it does not learn? I will continue this discussion in 1 minute. Here you see some examples. The input is that input sequence for numbers, for integers, and expected is the inverse of it, of course, from the training data. And this is the model prediction. And you see that the result is false, and somehow it can approach some results, but most of the time it has nothing related with the expected value sequence and the output sequence. So for our model, the simple model, which is a multi-layer perceptron model, here you see, cannot learn and seems that running more epochs will not help, because throughout these epochs we notice that it's going up and going down, going up and going down, and cannot learn. Actually, I have tried lots of different optimizers and the number of epochs, but it does not help. And you can try using this notebook on the Colab, which I shared the link below, and you can try it. Here, now, observations and conclusions. We learned sequence-to-sequence learning problem. Okay. We design and configure a sample problem, which we will be using during the tutorial series. We are going to use the same sample. And we coded a simple multilayer perceptron model using Keras sequential API. But we observed that MLP did not perform well, about 10% accuracy. Now, the question is why MLP fails? Okay, actually, the answer lies in the question. We are trying to solve a sequence-to-sequence problem. In sequence-to-sequence problem, remember the definition of the sequence. There is an order in the sequence, and the order is related with some context. But MLP does not pay attention to order of the inputted data. All right. So one reason why the MLP fails is that, but there are other reasons. The second thing that we can use recurrent neural networks, and it could be a good idea. Why it could be a good idea to use a recurrent neural network? The first simple answer is that the way that we design recurrent neural networks enables them to handle ordered data. That's the one reason. But there are other reasons. You can write down your arguments why MLP fails, but why recurrent neural networks can be successful. You can provide your arguments to the comments below, and I will provide feedback, and I will try to extend the discussion with you. Part A ends up here. We are gonna continue with Part B. In Part B, we are gonna using LSTM layers in recurrent neural network structure. but we just use the LSTM in a stack manner, and we will see that their success. So if you want to learn more about sequence-to-sequence learning, you can follow my Murat Karakaya Academy YouTube channel, or you can follow my blogs on Medium. Please subscribe to my channel so that you will be aware of whenever I prepare and upload all these upcoming tutorials. Thank you for watching.